والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to Hajj Step by Step. I'm your host, Musa Maguire. We appreciate you joining us for this comprehensive program on the rites of Hajj. And our guide for this Hajj is Muhammad Salah. Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Well, at this stage, we've almost reached the end of Hajj. We're now at the 12th or 13th of Dhul-Hijjah. But we want to cover some of the details of these final days just to make sure we hit on all the important points. You talked in the previous episode about the pilgrims staying at Mina during these days, the Ayyam al-Tashriq. What happens if someone does not stay at Mina during these days? Or what if they give someone else the authority to throw the stones for them, but they decide, well, okay, now I'm going to go stay in the hotel and have a good time?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفى. Praise be to Allah, we praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. We bear witness that there is no God who is worthy of worship but Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his last messenger. Concerning staying at Mina and spending the night at Mina particularly is a mandatory act amongst the rites of Hajj, which the pilgrim must do by himself, and it cannot simply be done by hiring or assigning somebody else to do it on their behalf. We said concerning stoning the Jamarat, a person who's weak, ill, or a pregnant woman, or a person who cannot go to throw the Jamarat, may ask somebody else to throw it on their behalf, and it's got to be done this way, that the person have to throw on behalf of himself or herself first, then on behalf of those who requested from them to throw the Jamarat on their behalf. And that has to be by their permission, so it cannot just happen by, voluntarily making it on behalf of somebody without giving them this authority. Those who do not stay the nights of Mina, or most of the night at Mina, they have violated one of the wajibat and the sha'air of Hajj, and they have to pay a ransom, which is slaughtering a sheep or giving a dam, as people normally call it, blood, to make up this violation, and to ask Allah's forgiveness for not staying without a valid reason. But those who just assign somebody else to throw the stones on their behalf, and simply they catch up with their plane, flight, or they stay at their hotel, they have messed up a big time, because assigning somebody to throw the stones on your behalf is permissible, but you've got to be there in Mina. You cannot just simply throw all the stones in one day and leave. And you cannot have somebody to throw on your behalf while you're sitting somewhere else, or you have left already Mecca, went to home or went to visit the prophetic masjid. Other people make another violation, which I would like to alert the pilgrims to, which is that they go to the next step, which is they perform tawaf al-wada' right after they perform tawaf al-ifada and so forth, and they go stay the 3 days and nights in Mina. And afterward, they're ready to leave, and they think by that they have done tawaf al-wada'. Trying to expedite the process will take you nowhere. Exactly what the Prophet ﷺ did, we have to follow. خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. We're commanded to follow the footsteps of the Prophet ﷺ, and every bit he did during his Hajj ﷺ, and not to change.
Sheikh, we talked several times about the sacrifice, both on the day of Eid, but also the sacrifice to make up for a mistake or some violation during the Hajj. What if a person cannot afford either one of these sacrifices, the one on the day of Eid or one that for some reason is required?
Well, it's very important to explain the difference between the two. The sacrifice, which is known as al-hajj, is mandatory upon one who is performing umrah and hajj in the same season of hajj, during the months of hajj, whether it is hajj al-tamattu' or hajj al-qiran. And that's to be done on the Eid day, the 10th day of Dhul-Hijjah. The description of this hadith is similar to the description of al-udhiyah. And similarly, the distribution of this sacrifice. A person may eat from that. Actually, he's recommended to eat and to drink from the soup of this sacrifice, give gifts to friends and others, and distribute one third of it or more to the poor and to the needy. As far as the fidya or the ransom, this is a penalty for a violation that the pilgrim has committed or a wajib that he missed. In this case, the ransom or the slaughter, the offering or the sacrifice he's given will be slaughtered there at the time of the violation, at the place of the violation, and it will be distributed among the poor, and he would not taste it or take anything out of it for himself.
Sheikh, we get to this issue now of tawaf al-wada', which is really the farewell tawaf. Is this the final step of Hajj, and what exactly are the requirements of this act?
Before we talk about tawaf al-wada', you asked me whether if a person cannot afford the Hajj, if there is an alternative or not. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stated in the Quran that if one cannot afford the sacrifice, al-Hajj, saying عز جل فصيام ثلاثة أيام في الحج وسبعة إذا رجعتم تلك عشرة كاملة ذلك لمن لم يكن أهله حاضر المسجد الحرام. Indicating that الحج is mandatory on one who is making Umrah and Hajj and he's not a Meccan, he's not from the Meccan dwellers. And if in case that he's not financially capable to afford this sacrifice or al-hajj, then he may do otherwise, fast 3 days during the hajj, which may begin by the first day of Ayyam al-Tashriq, but not the Eid day under any circumstances. And afterward, whenever he goes home, he can complete the 10 by fasting 7 days, and they don't have to be consecutive at home after he goes home. Now concerning Tawaf al-Wada', which is the last activity before departing Mecca to anywhere, whether to go on home, or if you're going to Medina and you're not planning to come back. Tawaf al-Wada', the word Wada' in Arabic is a farewell. That's why we should understand it this way, that we're giving a farewell to the ancient house, to Al-Kaaba. So it should be the last activity a person would do. And that's why I said it's not valid to do it then go and stay in Mina for Ayyam al-Tashriq. No. Once I'm done, I'm ready to leave. I wrapped up and I packed my luggages. And I'm waiting for my transportation a few hours before. I would allow some time to perform Tawaf al-Wada'. Tawaf al-Wada' is mandatory, is wajib. And for one who does not do it, will be made up by a penalty of offering the ransom of slaughtering either a sheep or anything that would make a fori. Tawaf al-Wada' will be done similar to any other tawaf, whether tawaf al-Qudum, tawaf al-Ifadah, tawaf al-Tatawwa', except that it is a wajib, it's not one of the pillars of al-Hajj. Who will be exempted from tawaf al-Wada'? Women during their menses, they will not have to do Tawaf al-Wada'. As for Safiya, may Allah be pleased with her, she experienced her menses after she did Tawaf al-Ifadah. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Awa habisatuna hi?" Is she going to withhold us here? Because if she did not do Tawaf al-Ifadah, they would have to remain until she would do Tawaf al-Ifadah, because it's a rukn, it's one of the pillars of Hajj. So the Prophet ﷺ was informed, "Ya Rasulullah, she already did Tawaf al-Ifadah." So he said, "Then let's go." That was an indication that a woman during her menses, If she did tawaf al-ifada, she does not have to do tawaf al-wida' and she may leave without paying any penalty or ransom or even worrying about it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her an ease in this condition.
Sheikh, are there certain common mistakes for tawaf al-wada'? We talked about some of the problems with the other kinds of tawaf, but are there some particular to this tawaf?
Yes. We normally see some people, upon performing tawaf al-wada', they leave backwards. They're facing the Kaaba and they sleep backwards, thinking this is a way to honor the Kaaba and to keep a covenant with the Kaaba that you may come back once again. This is a practice which the Prophet ﷺ did not do, nor any of his companions. And accordingly, this is an act of innovation. And while you are in Hajj or outside Hajj, you should follow exactly the traditions of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and not to innovate, even if you read that somewhere in any book. Others would make sure that they would wipe their hands and their bodies against some parts of the Kaaba other than the black stone, leaving some memories, and they would take their ihram off or their scarves for some women, and they would rub them against the Kaaba for good memories, so that they would be wrapped as a shroud for them upon their death and so on. All these acts are wrong acts, and the Hajj should avoid all of them.
You mentioned ihram. Is ihram, the garments of ihram, still worn at this stage by some, or is it permissible or impermissible?
Whenever we see people performing tawaf al-ifada, and we see them performing tawaf al-wada', they are normally in the case of their regular clothes, because they're not in a state of ihram. What I'm referring to is some people are keen to do those practices by rubbing their scarves for women or rubbing their ihram for men. This is wrong. But in tawaf al-ifada, of course, people would have taken off their ihram and they have taken a ghusl and adorned themselves for this rukn, which is a tawaf al-ifada. Tawaf al-wida', likewise, that a person is already in a state of tahallul and is not wearing al-ihram clothes.
Well, for many of the pilgrims, the journey will continue after Mecca. But before we get to that, after a break, do you have any words of advice just for the feeling at this time when you are leaving Mecca, when you've completed Hajj? Any final thoughts?
A lot. Just remember that you are totally a different person. You're now a newborn. You've come to this place with great hopes and expectations. You've come with loads of sins and bad deeds, and now all of that is gone. Remember the tears that you shed there in Mecca and while performing Hajj. Remember when you cried for your sins, when you begged Allah for mercy and forgiveness, and you renewed your covenant with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be a better person. So try to maintain that after you leave Mecca and you go home, and be a messenger of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Well, for many, as I said, after Mecca, there will also be a visit to the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes. And after a short break, we're going to get to that and hear some advice about how to approach that journey as well. So please stay with us for that. Assalamu alaikum.
If you look into the early tafsir, early exegesis of the Quran, you will find that all the mufassirin were trying to find out where are the seven earths. Earthquakes, natural or artificial, can delineate the boundaries between seven different zones within the earth. The conclusion that we have seven different layers within the earth came to not only the 20th century. The true believer would prostrate down in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the blessings of that prostration will reach the seventh earth.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Hajj Step by Step. After leaving Mecca, many pilgrims will decide to take a visit, make a visit to the Prophet's city, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Medina, and also to visit his masjid. Now, the first question I want to ask you is this visit a part of Hajj, or is it a mandatory component of Hajj?
No, actually, the visit to the prophetic masjid in the city of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Madinatul Munawwara is not a part of Hajj and has nothing to do with Hajj or Umrah at all. However, it is permissible during any time of the year, and it is recommended as well. Since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stated in one hadith that it's not permissible for any person to assume a journey, especially to visit any masjid to pray in, except one of the three masajid. Al-Masjid al-Haram in Mecca, and the Masjid of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Al-Madina, and the farthest mosque, Al-Masjid al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. And please join me to pray and ask Allah the Almighty to free Al-Masjid al-Aqsa, to make us able to offer Salah in Masjid al-Aqsa while we're alive.
Sheikh, you mentioned that before visiting Mecca, it's an etiquette that one should take a ghusl and make some preparations. Is there any preparations or etiquettes for entering either the city of Medina or the Prophet's mosque, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?
You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran stated that, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. Not only the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, but take your adornment, purify yourself before visiting or entering any masjid. Now we are visiting the second most sacred place on earth, which is al-Masjid al-Nabawi. The Prophet ﷺ said that one salah in his masjid is better than a thousand prayer in any other masjid. Of course, except Al-Masjid Al-Haram. Since one prayer, one salah in Al-Masjid Al-Haram is better than 100,000 prayer in any other masjid. So imagine the amount of reward you're collecting by offering a single salah at the prophetic masjid or Al-Masjid Al-Haram. And that's why I seize this opportunity and I remind my dear pilgrims or those who are going for Umrah not to waste this opportunity. If you're not eating, nor drinking, nor asleep, then you're either reciting Qur'an in the Masjid al-Haram, or Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or praying in any of them, and or making tawaf. Other than that, do not waste this opportunity at all.
Now, Shaykh, we know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is buried at the site of this masjid, in the masjid. What is the etiquettes for visiting the grave? Or perhaps I should ask first, is our purpose to visit the grave or the masjid or both?
The intention is actually to visit the prophetic masjid, to collect the reward which we just stated by praying there in the prophetic masjid. As far as your remark concerning that the Prophet ﷺ's grave is in the masjid, actually the Prophet ﷺ was not buried in the masjid. Mm. Nor did he order his companions to do so. As a matter of fact, he emphasized on the restriction of being buried in the masjid, whether it's a prophet or a righteous man. But during he was buried in his room, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was just adjacent to the masjid. And during the expansions which took place during the Umayyads, they included the rooms of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam within the masjid. So anyway, there are of course certain etiquette that a person would follow upon visiting the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is the entrance, as we see in the video. Of course, when you enter the masjid in general, or any masjid, not only the prophetic masjid, you step in with the right foot. And you say, أعوذ بالله العظيم وبوجهه الكريم وسلطانه القديم من الشيطان الرجيم اللهم اغفر لي ذنوبي وافتح لي أبواب رحمتك. I seek refuge with Allah, the greatest, and in His noble face, and in His eternal power from the outcast Satan. O Allah, forgive me my sins and open for me the doors of your mercy. Then you proceed in offering the salutation of the masjid or tahiyatul masjid and pray two rak'ahs tahiyatul masjid. It will be best if you get to offer these two rak'ahs in al-rawda, as we've just seen in the video, that al-rawda is an area between the the home or the room of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which he's buried in right now, and his minbar. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم stated in one hadith, ما بين بيتي ومنبري روضة من رياض الجنة. The area which is between my house and my minbar, the pulpit of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, is just a garden of the gardens of paradise. So imagine that this area is very, very great. If you can offer two rak'ahs there, do so, or even if you can do more, and then give time for somebody else to offer two rak'ahs as well, then proceed on to pay the visit to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and there will be also an etiquette of standing before him and saluting him, saying, "Assalamu alayka ayyuha an-nabiy wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh," with tranquility and calmness and complete khushu'. You're standing before the grave of the greatest man ever, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We were commanded in the Quran to send the peace and salutation upon him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Send much of peace and salutation upon the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You may do that while standing before his qabr sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And also you may say, اللهم آت محمدا الوسيلة والفضيلة وبعثهما مقاما محمودا الذي وعدته, which means, O Allah, grant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam al-wasila, which is the nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a special place, very near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. Al-fadila, the favor. والمقام المحمود is a praiseworthy position which Allah promised His Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم with in heaven.
Sheikh, we also know that two of the great companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم are buried next to him,
exactly.
Abu Bakr and Omar.
Exactly.
Is there also an etiquette for visiting their graves, or should we pass them by?
Sure. They were actually buried in the same room where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was buried. So you step ahead to your right, where there will be the grave of the great companion Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu ardah, and another step forward to the right, there will be the grave of Umar al-Khattab. May Allah be pleased with both of them and all the companions. Before each one, you will stop in front of his grave and greet them and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to send his mercy, forgiveness and pleasure upon them. You notice that we did not say anything about rubbing hands, touching, or raising hands and making dua. These are all acts which are totally wrong and can actually violate your entire journey. Whenever you are there before the qabr of the Prophet ﷺ, you only greet him and send the peace and salutation upon him. Similarly, with his companions, you greet them and pray and ask Allah to send his blessings upon them. But if you'd like to make supplications and dua, then you need to turn towards the Qibla and make your dua. You never ask of anything from the Prophet ﷺ or any humankind. You only ask of Allah, the Almighty, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Sheikh, you mentioned some of the incorrect practices or misconceptions about the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes you hear stories of people who claim that they went to the grave and they had a conversation with the Prophet, or he reached out and shook their hand and use this to maybe assert their own authority. Is there any basis for these kind of tales?
Nothing of that is true at all. You know, we can discuss this in details in another occasion, but right now, the right practice is to stand, as we said, and greet him quietly, in a peaceful manner. Then you step forward, you greet Abu Bakr, then Umar, then you step out or you turn towards the Qibla and you make your dua only to Allah, since these are the teachings of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya ghulam, idha sa'alta fas'alillah. If you ever ask, only ask of Allah. Wa idha ista'anta fasta'in billah. And if you seek help, only seek the help of Allah, not of any human, including Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Sheikh, we also know that many of the other great companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are buried in Medina, in a graveyard there. Is there an etiquette for visiting this graveyard? I mean, do we still know where it is, and how does a pilgrim?
Sure,
do
the
this?
Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go and visit them in a graveyard or a cemetery which is known as Al-Baqi'a. This is very near to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once you step out from the visit of the qabr of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you could see it to your right hand. At the corner, you go, if it is open or not, there Uthman ibn Affan, may Allah be pleased with him, and too many other companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mothers of the believers, are all buried there. You stand, or if you get to enter, and you greet them with the same greeting the Prophet ﷺ taught us, the greeting of the cemetery. As-salamu alaykum ahla al-diyari min al-mu'minina wal-muslimin. Wa inna insha'allahu bikum lahiqoon. Nas'alullaha lana wa lakum al-afiyah. That's it. Which is, peace be with you, the dwellers of this place among the believers and the Muslims. Insha'Allah, definitely we will join you. إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. We ask Allah to pardon you and us, and to protect you and us from the fire of hell and the horror of the Day of Judgment. Then this is the ziyarah and the only thing that a person may do. All other false practices such as making supplications there, crying and calling upon the dead, these are all acts of shirk without any doubt.
Sheikh, what about other landmarks that exist in Medina or things that, you know, will evoke our memory of the time of the Prophet ﷺ and his companions? What does exist to this day in Medina? Is it recommended to visit it? And are there any etiquettes?
As far as landmarks, there is plenty. But what's recommended to visit is Masjid Quba. This is the masjid which Allah mentioned in the Quran that لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى مِنْ أَوَّلِ يَوْمٍ أَحَقُّ أَن تَقُومَ فِيهِ. A masjid which is established on righteousness from the first day is more worthy to stand in it in prayer. The Prophet ﷺ used to perform wudu, and particularly on Saturday, and go and offer two rak'ahs there. He said, ﷺ, whoever performs perfect wudu and offers two rak'ahs in Masjid Quba, it would be considered, as far as the reward, as offering a umrah. There is a great reward for visiting Masjid Quba and praying two rak'ahs there. And the Prophet ﷺ used to do that oftenly. As I said, that at least once a week. There is also the sight scene of the Battle of Uhud, which took place in this area. It's important also to notice that there will be the graveyard of almost 70 of the martyrs, of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, amongst them Hamza, the Prophet's uncle, Asadullah, and Sayyid al-Shuhada, may Allah be pleased with him. So you stand there once again and you do like what we did in the first time by visiting the cemetery of Al-Baqi'. You greet the dwellers there and ask Allah al-Afiyah for yourself and for them. And that's it. People collecting stones and collecting memories from there and writing their names, or begging help from the companions who are already dead in this graveyard. These are all false practices. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us what will benefit us and to help us to understand our deen properly. Unfortunately, many people spend a lot of money and make a lot of effort, come from a long way, and by the end, they come and they do some shirk practices which would join their entire journey. May Allah guide all of us.
Sheikh, I really want to thank you for myself, and I'm sure for our viewers, for taking us through this journey of through Hajj and also to the visit to Medina. Though we're not finished, inshallah, we'll still deal with some more issues. So please stay tuned for our next episode. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لا إله إلا الله.